Hello, dear brothers and sisters. Welcome to another day of Read Through the Bible 2021. So happy to be with you today. This is Pastor Mark coming to you from my office at the Anaheim SDA Church. Hope that you have been blessed with a great Sabbath and a great 4th of July weekend. We are recording today for Monday, the 5th of July, kind of the observed holiday. Maybe many of you have a holiday day today. Want to wish you a belated happy 4th of July and to never take for granted the wonderful freedoms that we have. I was going to almost say that the government grants us, but it's more like the government recognizes the freedoms that God inherently gives us. Yes, as His children. We've got five chapters for you today. We got Joshua chapter 7, Psalm 137 and 138, Jeremiah 1, new book of the Bible, and Matthew 15 from the New Testament. Let's bow our heads and pray as we begin. Dear Lord Jesus, I'm so happy to be here with my brothers and sisters from the Orange and Anaheim SDA churches yet again, even though it is virtually, dear Lord. But I pray that their households are blessed. I pray that their homes are a place of peace and encouragement and refuge from the stresses of the outside world. Thank you, dear Lord Jesus, for the freedoms that we do enjoy. We never want to take them for granted. And we want to lift up in prayer Christians in other countries that are not so fortunate to be able to worship openly. I pray, dear Heavenly Father, that you would bring us through, that you would bring your great culmination of your plan of salvation in the second coming of Jesus, and I pray that we would be living to see it, dear Lord. As we prepare our hearts, please give us insight. Dear Holy Spirit, we ask you to come in and teach us just the principles that you would have for us. This word isn't always easy, but it is challenging, and it stretches us, and it grows us, and so we affirm that you are along with us on this path, and we want to always be going deeper with you, walking closer with you, and striving higher with you. So please bless each family, dear Heavenly Father, and bless us as we discuss together these chapters. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Okay, beginning with Joshua chapter 7. Israel is just coming off of one of its biggest victories. Can't even take credit directly for it. God's hand was working so mightily and so evidently in the Battle of Jericho. They routed the place. This was a big fortified city. And chapter 7 is about a small city that really, in the light of Jericho, shouldn't give them any trouble. Now, they set their sights on the next little town. It's called Ai. Joshua sends some people over there to survey the land, and they come back and they say, "This is easy. Don't even bother with the whole army." It was mentioned back in chapter 4 that the standing army was 40,000 people. Don't even bother them or weary them. Just send 2,000 or 3,000. We can take Ai easily. But what happens, friends? Those 3,000 go out to Ai and they are surprised. They are turned back at the city gates. They are routed. They are pursued. And about 36 of them die. What has gone on? Now, this is a surprise to Joshua and the rest of the Israelites, but the narrator, could be Joshua himself writing after the fact, the narrator gives us the reason why in verse 1. But Joshua and his men didn't know about what's said in verse 1 here. It says the Israelites had acted unfaithfully in regard to the devoted things back in Jericho. Achan, and then it gives several of the generations there, he took some of the devoted things, and so Yahweh's anger burned against Israel. You may remember that back in Jericho, God had said you are to take none of the plunder for your personal benefit. God knew the corrupting power that wealth has. There are several warnings against it, and we still see it evident today. And so, but somebody had broken that. They had obviously done it secretly, and Joshua and his men did not know about this. So, when Joshua hears the report, actually, end of verse 5, when the people hear the report, it says, "The hearts of the people melted and became like water." Interesting illustration. I mean, we've all been scared or heartbroken or something, but just to say, "My heart is water." Oh, boof. Just no strength, no resolution in it. Verse 6, Joshua tore his clothes and fell face down on the ground before the ark of Yahweh, remaining there till evening. The elders did the same, sprinkled dust in their heads. That's a sign of mourning. And Joshua cries out, "Sovereign Yahweh." Now, this is interesting. I don't recall Moses ever complaining to this degree. This sounds more like the gripes that the Israelites had. I don't know, maybe it's showing that Joshua doesn't quite have the maturity that Moses had, but look at this, the wordage here. "Why did you ever bring this people across the Jordan River to deliver us into the hands of the Amorites to destroy us? If only we had been content to stay on the other side of the Jordan." And that smacks of the Israelites saying, "Oh, why did we ever leave Egypt? It was better over there." God led you mightily across the Jordan, Joshua, and obviously his powerful hand was with you in Jericho, but he can't see that now. He sees the devastation of Ai, and he goes straight to the worst case scenario. Verse 8, "Oh Lord, what can I say now that Israel has been routed by its enemies? The Canaanites and the other people of this country will hear about this, and they will surround us and wipe out our name from the earth. What then will you do for your own great name?" Reminding him, your reputation is wrapped up in this as well. So he probably goes too far, because look at even how the Lord responds. Verse 10, Yahweh said to Joshua, "Stand up! What are you doing down on your face?" He doesn't like this whole prostration, and I don't know, he's like, you're overdoing it, man. Here's the reason. Verse 11, "Israel has sinned. They have violated my covenant, which I commanded them to keep. They have taken some of the devoted things. They have stolen, they have lied, they have put them with their own possessions." Now this, as well as verse 1, this reveals something that is very strange to us as Westerners. Westerners are famous for being individualists. I have my personal relationship with God. I've got like an acquaintance or friendship relationship with people at church. But beyond that, I'm kind of on my own. Yeah, I've got my family members. But if my neighbor over here does that, if my neighbor over here does that, that's not my business. What we see here is that the Eastern worldview, which includes the Middle East, sees society as much more communal than individual. We know from verse 1 it was a singular man's sin. Yet it says God's heart, end of verse 1 there, Lord's, Yahweh's anger burned against Israel, against the whole group. Why not just the one? And then he says Israel has sinned. They have coveted and stolen. They have lied. So there's a group identification here that supersedes the one individual. Now, we are going to see them root out the one individual, but until then, the blessing cannot be on the whole place. This has huge implications for us, and this actually makes me like shudder a little bit as a pastor, because however individually versus collectively minded we are, we're dealing with the same God. And if God is communally minded, then the secret sins that certain church members may have can definitely affect us. And the secret sins that our neighbors have in society can definitely affect the blessing that God has on the whole land. So I hope and I wish that people would take this warning very seriously for our modern day. Look at what is possible when the hand of God is with you, River Jordan and Jericho, but look what happens when God's mighty hand is removed. 3,000 routed by this little town and 36 die. Now this obviously begs the question, why didn't God talk to Joshua first? Why did he let them go in and have this defeat before he mentioned that anything was wrong? Could be a couple of things. Could be that first of all, Joshua in his overconfidence didn't bother to seek the Lord. You know, it's like, if we've conquered this big town over here, here's this little town over here. Joshua still could have gone to the tent, I imagine, and said, Yahweh, is this your will? And then Yahweh could have told him ahead of time, wait, there's a spiritual problem. Take that care of that first before trying to go against even this little town. So that's one possibility. The second possibility is that God stayed silent. He could have preemptively talked to Joshua. So it could be that Joshua didn't initiate a conversation with him, kind of forgot God, and God would have told him if he'd sought him. The second thing is God may have wanted there to be a lesson in the loss and in the shock. A lesson for future generations to learn from. Definitely future generations of Israel to learn from, but what about us, dear friends? Man, this makes me resolve so much more strongly. I'm always against sin, and I'm always praying to God, give us your perspective on sin, help me to hate sin the way that you do. But for the sake of others in the community, like, it's bad enough probably if 2 or 3 or 10 or a certain percentage of church members have some secret sin. What if the pastor has secret sin? What if Joshua had the secret sin? My goodness. So it just makes me resolve all the more fully to be careful myself and to be urging carefulness on the part of others. Not that God is vengeful. I mean, it does say that he's angry about this. You know, these are his covenant people, and they're pretty quickly, they keep falling into this. But it's just like, we can't expect his blessing if we're knowingly disregarding his principles. You know, God gives us the easy part. He's doing huge things here, and all he says is walk in my covenant, and the amazing things will continue to happen. He offers us nothing less than the plan of salvation. Follow these principles. They lead to abundant life. You know, his commands, his teachings, his principles. And we think we know better in little things, you know? My work won't care if I skim off 3% for myself kind of thing. I just pray everybody would search their own hearts and make sure that they are clear. Look at this. And this is a precursor, probably an illustration of the judgment. Let's see. Before we get to that, though, verse 12. That is why the Israelites cannot stand against their enemies. They turn their backs and run because they have been made liable to destruction. I will not be with you anymore unless you destroy whatever among you is devoted to destruction. So God says, your days are numbered as a people. You will be routed by any little army or town unless you root this out. Here is God's instruction, verse 13. Go, consecrate the people. Tell them, consecrate yourselves in preparation for tomorrow. For this is what Yahweh, the God of Israel, says. That which is devoted among you, O Israel, you cannot stand against your enemies until you remove it. Now, I happened to read the NKJV before I read the NIV, and it said cursed there. Interesting that NIV chooses to use the word devoted, whereas NKJV says cursed. Now, it certainly became a curse to Israel, but these things were to be devoted to God, and I think destroyed as an offering to God. So, here is the process. In the morning, present yourselves tribe by tribe. The tribe that Yahweh takes shall come forward clan by clan. The clan that Yahweh takes shall come forward family by family. And the family that Yahweh takes shall come forward man by man. He who is caught with the devoted things shall be destroyed by fire, along with all that belongs to him. He has violated the covenant of Yahweh and has done a disgraceful thing in Israel. Wow, destruction by fire. A couple of principles there. This could be a precursor or an illustration of the fire that will consume and purify the earth, and the wicked will die in their sins in the lake of fire. We saw that not too long ago at the end of Revelation. Secondarily, fire is a chemical process that cannot be reversed. Once you burn a log in a fireplace, you can never unburn that log. It is a permanent state of physical change. And so it really has the implication of the finality of it, which is also what we believe about the lake of fire, ultimate finality. So the whole camp hears this, the whole camp goes to bed. There is secret sin somewhere in the camp. If I can take a minute, this reminds me of a story when we were on our senior trip. Class of 98, we were in Hawaii for our senior trip. And there was a student who I maybe on a dare or something, from a pretty wealthy family, so I don't think he needed to do it, but stole a couple CDs from Tower Records and got caught and got arrested and taken to jail. And one of our sponsors had to go and vouch for him, and he and the sponsor got on the first flight home, but a few students knew what had happened. And we had a powwow in the night. We had a powwow in the night in the basement of the hotel saying, nobody tell this to anybody back at school because administration needs to determine how to discipline this person and how to let the news out. Well, apparently the next day at school back in California, everybody knew about it. It was the buzz on everybody's lips, which meant that somebody had leaked from Hawaii. Somebody had called somebody back, you know, one of the underclassmen, and told them about this. And the whole school was a buzz. And so the next night we had another meeting in the basement of the hotel, and the big question was, who told? You all knew you were not supposed to let this be told. And we sat there in this circle, probably 30 of us sat there in the circle looking at each other, and we knew that someone had a secret sin, but nobody would confess. And people would get angry and make threats, and then others would say, no, don't do that, because that's not going to occur. And we sat there till probably 1 a.m. You know, they were like, we're going to sit here until we figure out who did it. And nobody spoke up. Nobody confessed. And I felt like this, is it I, Lord? Is it I, Lord? Well, that mystery ended up the end of the school year with nobody knowing who had snitched. It wasn't only till years and years later that I heard who that person was. And just, so that's my own example of just like having been in a situation with secret sin. Wow. All right, let's return here. So imagine how this person feels. He is now questioning, can God really discern? Can God really bring me out? Or maybe he thought there may be others who also did it. Maybe they'll be found and not me. But what is Achan thinking at this point? Verse 16. Early the next morning, Joshua had Israel come forward by tribes, and Judah was taken. Judah was chosen. The clans of Judah came forward, and he took the Zerahites. Now, how? How? It says the one that Yahweh selects. How did they do this? Did they do the Urim and the Thummim? Was it a special revelation to Joshua? We simply don't know. Joshua had his... Okay, and then from within the Zerahites, the family of Zimri was taken. Joshua had his family come forward, man by man. And Achan, son of Carmi, son of Zimri, son of Zerah, tribe of Judah, was taken. Then Joshua said to Achan, "My son, give glory to Yahweh, the God of Israel. Give him praise. Tell me what you have done. Do not hide it from me." Interesting how Joshua is demanding glory and praise for Yahweh. I mean, maybe it's like, confess that Yahweh knows how to do this. I don't know. It's almost like, I don't know. I don't know how to take this. I mean, Yahweh is always worthy of praise, but having been caught in a lie, praise Yahweh right now. Give him glory and confess what you did. Verse 20, Achan replied, "It is true, I have sinned against Yahweh, the God of Israel. This is what I have done." You know, how different might this have been if Achan had come to Joshua the evening before and confessed before? Maybe he wouldn't have had to die, although the death decree was already given. I don't know. He thought no one will know. "When I saw in the plunder a beautiful robe from Babylonia, 200 shekels of silver and a wedge of gold weighing 50 shekels, I coveted them and I took them. They are hidden in the ground inside my tent with the silver underneath." So Joshua sent messengers and they went to the tent and they brought the things back. They spread it out before Yahweh. Verse 24, "Then Joshua, together with all Israel, took Achan son of Zerah, the silver, the robe, the gold wedge, his sons and daughters, his cattle, his donkeys and sheep, his tent and all that he had to the valley of Achor. Joshua said, 'Why have you brought this trouble on us? Yahweh will bring trouble on you today.' Then all Israel stoned him. And after they had stoned the rest, they burned them. Over Achan, they heaped up a large pile of rocks, which remains to this day. Then Yahweh turned from his fierce anger. Therefore, that place has been called the Valley of Achor ever since." Valley of Achor, my study Bible tells me, the Valley of Trouble. And there's that phrase once again. The pile of rocks is there to this day. That supports an early date for writing this, that would have still been there. So this is like inviting the Israelites. Do you want to take your children to go see the monument of where they crossed the Jordan River? You can go see that. Do you want to go and see the pile of rocks where Achan was killed? You can go see that. It's kind of like a visual history lesson for Israel. For anybody at the time of first receiving this book, anybody that wants to go and show their children or see it for themselves, they can do so. Now, here we have the hugely ethical problem of the sons and daughters dying with Achan. There are places in the Bible where you find both phrases, that the sins of the fathers will fall on the children for the second and third generation. But then, I believe in Ezekiel, it says that a child shall not die for his father's sins, nor a father for his son's sins. So what's going on here? First of all, a couple of possibilities. It could have been that the children knew about Achan's sin and were also keeping it secret. So they would have been complicit as well. That is a possibility. The other possibility is, again, the communal identity before the individual identity. The family is viewed as the problem, and the family needs to be rooted out. Now, we don't like that, especially as Westerners, but that is the way that they operate in Eastern cultures. A couple of weeks back, I remember there was something, it was something about a king saying, "Kill them and their whole family." And I was asking if God ever demanded the whole family to be killed. We don't see God specifically demand the other family members need to be killed, but God did use the phrase, "all that belongs to him." And families, I do believe, were viewed as belonging to the patriarch. You know, they were kind of, you know, possessions. And so it does talk about the belongings, the animals, and the family members all facing this. So this is a judgment that we might view as too harsh. But again, we don't have all the details. We don't know the thoughts in Achan's head. And again, I know I keep harping on this, but it's the idea of bringing the judgment forward to be a warning to others. If Achan was going to die and then eventually be judged and burned in the lake of fire anyway, to move it up so that it can be a deterrent to others can be, in the long term, a life saver. So that's a possibility. So, not a pleasant chapter by any means. But it is interesting. They had just such a big victory over such a big country, and then they have a defeat against such a small town. And the difference is a small sin. The lesson, I've heard pastors preach on this, and I think it is a correct application. A small sin can be a huge hindrance in your spiritual life. Don't mess with it. Confess it early before it's found out, right? Jesus says everything that's done in secret will be shouted from the mountaintops. I'm very interested to know. I mean, we know our share of political scandals and things like that, but how much don't we know that one day will be shouted from the rooftops? Confess that stuff now. Purge the sin now, that it might not be a hindrance to yourself, your family, your church community. And, you know, don't let it get to this point. Achan, you know, apparently, I would imagine this is several days, if not a week or 2 weeks after Jericho, and Achan could have confessed and come up before the Ai problem or immediately after the Ai problem, before God decreed the death sentence on this person. And man, but Achan, you don't see any modern day children walking around named Achan, and that's why, because the only example is a bad one in the Bible. So I love Bible names, but boy, wouldn't name anybody Achan. Well, I hope that you glean a warning from this. It is better to be warned and then to avoid the pitfall, then to experience a pitfall yourself. So thank you, Lord, for this warning, even though it's not pleasant to perceive it. Moving on to our Psalms passage now, we have two Psalms today, Psalm 137 and 138. Before we dive into 137, though, I have to mention 136, which there's a very well-known praise psalm that is formulated after that, and so we're going to tag that on at the end of the video. But you hopefully read yesterday that there is a repeated line in there, and it really sounds like it's meant to be like a call and response. And so wait all the way till the end to enjoy that song. It's a praise song that I enjoy playing myself. Psalm 137, we have no note of it being attributed to anyone in particular, but the first verse does have a famous song. Now, this is a sad and tragic psalm. This could be the saddest of all the psalms. But the song that goes with it, it's funny. It kind of puts a happy spin on it. So I'll read it here, and then I'll play you how this has been put to music. It says, "By the rivers of Babylon, we sat and wept when we remembered Zion." Let's listen to that clip of the song here. The psalm goes on to say, "There on the poplars we hung our harps, for there our captors asked us for songs. Our tormentors demanded songs of joy, and they said, sing us one of the songs of Zion." How terrible. I mean, this is almost like spiritual torture to be asked to sing one of the songs of Zion by somebody who's taking you away from Jerusalem. "For how can we sing the songs of Yahweh while in a foreign land? If I forget you, O Jerusalem, may my right hand forget its skill. May my tongue cling to the roof of my mouth if I do not remember you, if I do not consider Jerusalem my highest joy. Remember, O Yahweh, what the Edomites did on the day Jerusalem fell. Tear it down, they cried. Tear it down to its foundations. O daughter of Babylon, doomed to destruction, happy is he who repays you for what you have done to us. He who seizes your infants and dashes them against the rocks." And that makes me just back up and say, whoa, 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 whoa. We've had plenty of psalms where we see, you know, like a desire for destruction of the wicked. But this just seems to be like a bloodthirsty lust for revenge that is just beyond the pale. To say happy is the one who dashes the infant's skulls against the rocks, like that is just sadistic. I mean, these guys have had their soul torn out in a way that you and I can't understand. But, boy, it just starts bad and gets worse. I'd be very interested to know. I mean, it's true. In the old system, where they thought the plan was through the nation of Israel, and Jerusalem was the center, and within Jerusalem the temple was the center. That has been dashed at this point. And we could debate whether this is prophetic or whether this is after the fact. I guess I lean toward after the fact, although I always conceive of most, if not all, the Psalms being written during David and Solomon's time and perhaps compiled in Babylon. But this one definitely sounds like one that is in Babylon. But boy, the fact that this was put to music, the mourning of being forced to sing about it by your captors and then just wishing for revenge to the point of dashing infants' heads against the rocks. Just a terrible sentiment. I'm shocked that this is in the Bible. Moving on to Psalm 138 now, we do get a text note that this is a Psalm of David. I was thinking we're getting toward the end of Psalms. Could this be the last Psalm? And no, it's not. The next several are going to be from David. But this is the last section of Psalms from David. 145 is the last Psalm of David, and 138 through 145, all of them are from David. But then, in a little less than a week, we'll be saying goodbye to the Psalms of David. But here is how it reads. I will praise you, O Yahweh, with all my heart. Before the gods, I will sing your praise. And that immediately gave me a question. The second most used term for God after Yahweh is Elohim. And I am, the im at the end of Hebrew words is the way you pluralize it. Just like in English or Spanish, you put an S at the end, right? Book to books. The difference is an S. And it's as obvious to us that yes, an S obviously pluralizes. That is how obvious it is in Hebrew. And so I looked it up interlinear, and it is in fact the word Elohim. And so I thought, well, maybe it's not gods, maybe it's God. But then that seems strange, like I will praise Yahweh before Elohim, and we don't believe those are differences. So it probably is contrasting the one true God. Like I will, maybe the idea is in the temple of these polytheistic gods, I will still stick up for you. My study Bible here says it could also mean kings, perhaps. I guess there are other places where in context that term apparently means kings. But this is a much more pleasant psalm, as we can see. I will bow down toward your holy temple and will praise your name for your love and your faithfulness, for you have exalted above all things your name and your word. When I called, you answered me. You made me bold and stout-hearted. May all the kings of the earth praise you, O Yahweh, when they hear the words of your mouth. May they sing of the ways of Yahweh, for the glory of Yahweh is great. Though Yahweh is on high, he looks upon the lowly, but the proud he knows from afar. Though I walk in the midst of trouble, you preserve my life. You stretch out your hand against the anger of my foes. With your right hand you save me. Yahweh will fulfill his purpose for me. Your love, O Yahweh, endures forever. Do not abandon the works of your hands. Beautiful. I can really resonate with that. I'm thankful for that. Now, this one, obviously, if the previous one was in the Babylonian times, this, I guess we're doing a rewind here back to the time of David. So I don't think in any place were we even considering that the Psalms would be chronological in order. These have been compiled, and you know, your guess is as good as mine, the reason by which they were compiled. It seems like these last seven is kind of like another collection of David's Psalms. We certainly had the section of the Psalm of Ascents, and we have the five books, five scrolls of Psalms. So, you know, some hints there about the organization of it. But just praise the Lord. I long for the day as well when all the rulers of the earth, all the different nations affirm God's holiness, his sovereignty over all. Moving on to our next section. Just yesterday we finished the extensive prophecies, the collection of prophecies from Isaiah, and today we are in Jeremiah chapter 1. You may want to pause here and go and look at the overview video if you haven't done so already, although a good amount of the information in the overview video comes from chapter 1, because there's quite a bit of biographical and even autobiographical information in this chapter. Starts out saying, the words of Jeremiah, son of Hilkiah, one of the priests at Anathoth in the territory of Benjamin. My study Bible here says that Anathoth was only about 3 miles from Jerusalem, and it was one of four Levitical towns in Benjamin. You remember that each of the tribes had a few towns where the Levites would live, I guess when they weren't on duty at the temple. The word of Yahweh came to him in the 13th year of the reign of Josiah, son of Amon, king of Judah. and through the reign of Joiakim, son of Josiah, king of Judah, down to the fifth month of the 11th year of Zedekiah, son of Josiah, king of Judah, when the people of Jerusalem went into exile. So here from chapter 1, it talks about he prophesies during the reign of many kings, and then off until there is no more kingship because the people are carted off into exile in Babylon. How sad. Look for more detail if you go to the book overview video. Now it starts talking in the first person. It says, "The word of Yahweh came to me saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I set you apart. I appointed you as a prophet to the nations." Fascinating thought. God has his plans before we are aware of them, before even we come to be. I know it's in one of the Psalms, "Surely every day was written in your book before one of them came to be." And so the idea that God knows the future, it kind of boggles our minds, but we see it several places in Scripture. Here is Jeremiah's response. He does not feel worthy to be a prophet. "Oh, sovereign Yahweh," I said, "I do not know how to speak. I'm only a child." Self-deprecating there. Verse 7, "But Yahweh said to me, do not say I'm only a child. You must go to everyone I send you and to say whatever I command you. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you and will rescue you, declares Yahweh. Then Yahweh reached out his hand and touched my mouth and said to me, now I have put my words in your mouth. See, today I appoint you over nations and kingdoms to uproot and tear down, to destroy and overthrow, to build and to plant." What must he be thinking as this is going on? And then a couple of tests here. Maybe God is wanting to make sure the visions are getting through. "Word of Yahweh came to me. What do you see, Jeremiah?" "I see the branch of an almond tree," I replied. Yahweh said to me, "You have seen correctly, for I am watching to see that my word is fulfilled." Then the word of Yahweh came to me again. "What do you see?" "I see a boiling pot tilting away from the north," I answered. Yahweh said to me, "From the north, disaster will be poured out on all who live in the land. I'm about to summon all the peoples of the northern kingdom," declares Yahweh. Now, this is interesting. We can put up a map here about how the invasion came from Babylon. You will see that even though Babylon is almost due east, the armies more regularly would take the northern, you know, you've heard of the Fertile Crescent in the Middle East. Yes, the Fertile Crescent route allowed them to stay near waterways. They could go straight across, but they kind of had to sprint across because there was just barren desert there. So here's that picture for a moment. And so frequently, not only in Jeremiah, the invasion is talked about as coming from the north. Now, these next two verses, verse and a half, are in poetic form. So interesting that God breaks out into poetry here. "Their kings will come and set up their thrones in the entrance of the gates of Jerusalem." Thought I had here was, remember that the elders used to sit at the gates and they would kind of do judgments whenever there was a disagreement. But enemy kings will come and set up in that place of authority. "They will come against all her surrounding walls and against all the towns of Judah. I will pronounce my judgments on my people because of their wickedness in forsaking me, in burning incense to other gods, and in worshiping what their hands have made." Idolatry, big problem. God seems to have been harping on idolatry since Deuteronomy, but they never learned the lesson. I wonder if we seem as stubborn in any area as these Israelites did with idolatry. Verse 17, back to regular paragraph form here. "Get yourself ready. Stand up and say to them whatever I command you. Do not be terrified by them, or I will terrify you before them." That almost seems like, you know, kind of a rude way that parents talk to their kids sometimes. "Don't cry, or I'll give you something to cry about. Don't be terrified of these kings, or I will terrify you in their presence. You'll really have something to be terrified about." Yikes. "Today I have made you a fortified city, an iron pillar, and a bronze wall to stand against the whole land, against the kings of Judah, its officials, its priests, and the people of the land. They will fight against you, but will not overcome you, for I am with you and will rescue you," declares Yahweh. So I appreciate Jeremiah's honesty here. He doesn't feel like he's up to the task, but God says, do not fear, I will strengthen you, I will fortify you. We can only speculate as to how Jeremiah felt when God used those three illustrations, a fortified city, an iron bar, a bronze wall to these people, the strongest things that were known in the ancient world. God prophesies this will be a difficult ministry, but you will come through it. They will not overcome you. So as we talked about in the book overview, Jeremiah is one of the most autobiographical prophets. Interesting that you just see certain prophets being more transparent and open about their own feelings, their own life, and others are much more closed. But we're going to learn a lot about how Jeremiah is feeling through all of this. So I'm thankful for this chapter. It seems very accessible, and even while there's some big daunting things in it, I myself don't feel particularly confused by it, which is nice. So, hope many blessings are in store for Jeremiah, and even more important than just like feeling blessed, that we would learn the lessons so that we wouldn't be doomed to repeat the problems that Israel had in the past. Okay, at this time we're going to switch to our New Testament passage. We got Matthew 15 today. Now, January Pastor Mark did cover Matthew 15, so we're going to hand it off to him. Take it away, January Pastor Mark. Let's move on to New Testament now. We are in Matthew chapter 15, and we're going to see a debate that arises. Looks like, you know, those spies are following Jesus now, and they're wanting to find something to accuse him on. And they notice that his disciples are eating their food without doing the ceremonial washing required by the book of Leviticus. Now, God did give principles of washing. Fascinating, because they did not have germ theory at the time, but God knew it was good for them to wash their hands. Even though they didn't, I don't believe, have soap at the time, it's still better. You know, water is better than nothing to wash off the grime that you get on your hands during the day. And everything at the time was voiced in the form of a commandment. So the Jews saw it as a ceremony, but it was a ceremony absolutely that promoted health. So they witnessed Jesus and his disciples eating, and they say, huh, they're not doing the required ceremonial washing before. Why don't they wash their hands? Verse 2. Jesus replies, he's so indignant here. He's, you know, they're nitpicking, and he's going to point out how they deny much bigger commandments of God. Why do you break the command of God for the sake of your traditions? For God said, honor your father and mother. Here's a much bigger command, much more important. It's in the Ten Commandments, right? This other hand-washing stuff is one of the secondary levels. But if you say, verse 5, that anyone declares what might have been used to help their mother and father is devoted to God, they are not to honor their father and mother with it. Basically, people could have the excuse to not help their family, rather give a large donation to the synagogue, and then they would get honor from God while their parents are going hungry. And Jesus says, by doing that, you nullify the word of God for the sake of your tradition. You hypocrites! Isaiah was right when he prophesied about you. And it says, these people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. They worship me in vain, but their teachings are merely human rules. That comes from Isaiah 29:13, and this is sharp. He's saying, you are a fulfillment of a negative prophecy of the Old Testament. All for asking about hand washing. You know, I can imagine that they're really getting their hair blown back at this point. Jesus called the crowd, verse 10, and said, listen and understand. What goes into someone's mouth does not defile them, but what comes out of their mouth, that is what defiles them. Then the disciples, verse 12, came and said, didn't you know you offended the Pharisees when they heard this? He replied, every plant that my heavenly Father has not planted will be pulled up by the roots. Leave them, Pharisees. Leave them. They are blind guides. If the blind lead the blind, both will fall into the pit. Peter says, please explain this parable to us. Jesus says, are you so dull? You can sense Jesus' frustration with his own close ones. Don't you see that whatever enters the mouth goes into the stomach and then out the body? But the things that come out of a person's mouth come from the heart, and these defile them. Out of the heart come evil thoughts, murder, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, false testimony. These are what defile a person. But eating with unwashed hands does not defile a person. Now, some people will say that this has to do with no more clean and unclean meats. This was not the issue on the table at all. Nobody was eating unclean meats here. It was about, do you have to do that ceremonial washing of hands? We still recommend the washing of hands, but we don't make it a rule. You know, at potluck time, we don't check everyone's hands. We, of course, encourage cleanliness. We have the dispensers and things there. But so So let's be so, so much more careful about what comes out of our mouth. Truly, out of the overflow of our hearts comes things out of the mouth. I think we talked a couple days ago about using our mouths to bless, to edify, to encourage, to speak truth and beauty. We can do a lot of harm with our mouth. We can do a lot of beauty with our mouth. Book of Proverbs and some other places are going to have a lot to say about that. Now, next story here is a very fascinating story. One of the well-known stories. Jesus withdraws to the region of Tyre and Sidon, and a Canaanite woman from that vicinity comes to him crying out, "Master, my daughter is demon-possessed and suffering terribly." Jesus did not answer, so his disciples urged her, "Send her away. She keeps calling out after us." Jesus said, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of Israel." This is fascinating because you can imagine before Jesus' incarnation, he and God are looking down on the world. Jesus' plan obviously is to start the light of the gospel showing in Israel and from there to go around the world. Jesus seems to be saying it's not the time for the Gentiles right now. But the woman came and knelt before him, "Lord, help me." Oh, and earlier she had affirmed him, "Lord, Son of David." So, I mean, she's referring to his messianic heritage, calling him Lord. Jesus replied, here's an interesting illustration, but this is, it seems like Jesus' justification to not do a miracle here. Verse 26, "It's not right to take the children's bread and to toss it to the dogs." Wow, did he just call her and other Canaanites dogs? Problematic here. Verse 27, "Yes, it is, Lord," she said, "but even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from the master's table." So she picks up his illustration. She says, I can take that and run with it. The dogs do get their crumbs, even though it isn't offered to them directly. Jesus says to her, verse 28, "Woman, you have great faith. Your request is granted." And her daughter was healed at that moment. So this is a story that seems to be ethically problematic. It really seems Jesus wasn't going to solve this woman's problem. But I wonder also, we believe in our own faith life that God wants to do more than just do miracles. He wants to also stretch our faith in the meantime. And this is why we're told in various places in the Bible to pray persistently. Yes, we can say the prayer once, please heal this person in our church, and then drop it. God heard the request. But he wants us to pray persistently so that our faith will be stretched as well. And then whether or not we get the miracle, our faith has grown and hopefully we have more stamina for the future. You know, it's just like people working out either for endurance like marathons or triathlons or for strength, right? You stress out the muscles to their max so that they will heal stronger. And so it could very well be that Jesus is expertly discerning this woman's character. We all know people who are spunky. We all know people who can take a healthy debate. And maybe Jesus saw this characteristic in her. And maybe he knew from the beginning, I tend to think so, that he knew he was going to do this miracle. But he also wanted her to stretch for it and grasp for it and go to the end, to really exert her faith to grab that blessing there. And she rises to the challenge, you know? I can think of a particular friend from high school who's so spunky and always has a retort. And if Jesus knew that about this woman through his divine, you know, discernment and perception, maybe he knew that she would be up for this conversation and, you know, even willing to degrade herself and, yes, put herself in the place of the dog. But such a witty retort. And in faith, yes, Master, you're right. But even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall off the master's table. I grew up with little dogs, and it's so true. They sit there expectantly the whole dinner time, just hoping to get a morsel. That's what it was like for these Gentiles, hoping for a miracle. Twice now, Jesus has said, I have seen great faith with the centurion a few chapters ago, greater faith than he's seen in all of Israel. I love it when Gentiles impress Jesus with their faith. This wasn't even supposed to be the focus of his ministry, but they come and they pleasantly surprise him, for lack of a better term, and they get the miracle that they are yearning for. The next story is another miraculous feeding. I think it was just yesterday that we had the feeding of the 5,000. This one is a little lesser known. In fact, a lot of Christians remember that Jesus fed a crowd, but they forgot that he did it twice. Jesus now leaves and goes along the Sea of Galilee, goes up on a mountainside and starts teaching the people. The crowds came to him. They brought all their sick, lame, blind, demon-possessed, and he healed them all, praise the Lord, verse 30. People were amazed. They praised the God of Israel. Jesus calls his disciples and says, I have such compassion on these people. They have been with me 3 days and have had nothing to eat. Can you imagine? I think they were just camping out in the open air kind of thing. Because if you would return home, you could easily get something to eat. But imagine being so gripped by Jesus to go 3 days and not even on the second day be complaining about food. This is so fascinating. I don't want to send them away hungry. They may collapse on the way. They're hungry to the point of weakness, Jesus says. Compassion. The disciples say, where could we get enough bread to feed these people? And I'm like, guys, do you not remember the miracle of the last chapter? They're so dense, right? But then I have to look at myself in the mirror. Am I also dense about remembering God's, you know, mighty works? Yes, I am. So I have to be easier on the disciples here. How could we get enough bread in this remote place to feed such a crowd? How many loaves do you have? Jesus said. 7, they replied. A few small fish. This is one of two hints that reminds me this is not an accidental retelling of the previous story. The number of loaves is different than in the last one. He told the crowd to sit on the ground. Same principle we talked about yesterday. Had these people not been sitting? Was Jesus' teaching so gripping that they were standing and not paying attention to the aches that their bodies were given for standing hour after hour, day after day? Sit down on the ground. He took the 7 loaves and the fish and gave thanks. He gave it to the disciples, and they in turn to the people. They all ate and were satisfied, and afterward the disciples picked up 7 basketfuls, also a different number of basketfuls. Last time it seemed to be a basketful for every disciple, 12 basketfuls. This seems to be a basketful for every loaf. 7 loaves become 7 basketfuls after everybody has had their fill. The number of those who ate was 4,000 men. Last time was 5,000, this time 4,000, besides the women and children. We talked about yesterday we could easily double that number, perhaps 2.5 or 3 times that number to include the women and the children. I don't know why they counted that way. Obviously, patriarchal society, they paid more attention to men. But, the number of people, the amount they're going to eat, you know. After Jesus had sent the crowd away, he got into the boat and went to the vicinity of Magadan. So, Jesus has showed repeatedly. This wasn't a fluke the first time. He can do it again. Hopefully, the disciples will be getting this into their mind, that we needn't be worried for our physical sustenance when we are around Jesus. Praise the Lord for the compassion that he had on the Canaanite woman, on the people, even while enduring criticism from the Jewish leaders. May we, similarly, never shut down our generosity because we receive criticism from others. You know, God calls us to be open-handed to people because he has been open-handed to us. And yes, some people will abuse that, some people will criticize us for it, but we're not to change.
The mighty hand and outstretched arms. sing.